Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Engineers India Limited Q2 FY22 earnings conference call hosted by DAM Capital Advisors Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Ms. Bhoomika Nair. Thank you, and over to you, ma'am.
Thanks, Faizan. Warm good evening to everyone. Welcome to the Q2 FY22 earnings call of Engineers India. The management today is being represented by Ms. Pratika Shukla, CMD and Additional Charge Director Finance, Mr. Suvendu Padu, Company Secretary, Mr. R.P. Batra, Group General Manager, FNA and IR, Mr. Vinay Kalia, Chief General Manager, M&BD and IR. Over to you, ma'am, for your initial remarks, post which we'll open up the floor for Q&A.
Thank you so much, and good evening to all who have joined us in the Q2 earnings call. The company in the interim of the last board meeting, which was held on the 12th of August, till this board meeting, 360th board meeting held on 11th of November, has been active and has secured some major orders for the PMC and EPCM jobs for the CPCL's 9 million ton Cauvery Basin refinery. There has been activity on the LNG front as well, for our businesses, wherein we have expansion planned for the Petronet LNG, for which we will be working. As well as we will be engaged with them in terms of other business prospects for the company. The company also, in the projects that are being executed, has progressed very well in the HMEL polymer addition project, which is one of the world's largest. It is 1.2 million ton cracker, which is going in very good stead in terms of both the physical progress and the time we will take for commissioning that. There were some of our own technologies which also underwent performance test run in engine oil, and also some excellent site activities with minimal lost time accident for some of our sites. Of course, there were many other activities in terms of the compliance with respect to the quality management systems. EIL also entered into a collaboration agreement with Evergreen Technologies Private Limited for the marketing, supply, development of proprietary items and some innovative products. We also conducted, as our association with the manufacturing industry is from several decades and very robust, we also had several vendor meetings and also conducted a focused e-vendor meet for MSME suppliers, for SCST suppliers, as well as women entrepreneurs. This is a brief of our major activities, and I will leave it to our CGM and GGM, who will take this forward, who represent this well, Mr. Vinay Kalia and Mr. Batra.
Good evening to all of you. Just to debrief again the results of Q2. As on Q2, our consultancy turnover was 351 crores, and turnkey turnover was 296 crores, totaling to 647 crores, with an other income of around 28 crores. As of H1, if you add Q1 and Q2 numbers, consultancy turnover was 717 crores with turnkey of 665 crores, totaling to 1382 crores, with other income of 50 crores. And total income was 1433 crores. Consultancy segment profit as of H1 was 199 and turnkey was 19 crores, totaling to 218 crores. As CNMD ma'am has already clarified, we have secured a major order from Kaveri Basin Refinery, and we have secured some design and licensing orders from NRL. We have secured a pipeline order from BPCL, and going forward, we are looking forward to major expansions in Indian oil PSU projects, which we will be targeting in 21-22 and 22-23. As far as the total business secured is concerned, we have secured a business of 1450 crores as of 30th September, and we wish to improve upon these numbers by the end of this year to meet our MOU targets. We would now like to invite your Q&A so that we can take it up.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one at this time. The first question is from the line of Anuj Sharma from M3 Investments. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for this opportunity. Ma'am, my first question is, you know, we have announced a revenue target of 5,000 crores by 2025. Can you just broadly help us understand what are the broad opportunities and which segments, you know, we are targeting to achieve this kind of turnover?
So, when we are looking for our growing our year-on-year turnover, this is the target, and the it is done at roughly something like 10%, more than 10%, about 13% per annum year-on-year growth. The sectors that we are targeting is definitely the investment opportunities in the oil and gas sector, which is our core strength. And therein we are looking at the expansion of refinery capacity to 440 million tons in the future, as well as looking at the expansion of the gas grid and the penetration of gas in the primary energy mix from 6.5% today to about 15%. The challenges today in the country are that we need a lot of petrochemical, and that's something which we are focusing in a variety of projects, variety of clients, not just in the commodity polymers, but also in the niche petrochemicals, one of which we have already completed, which is BPCL's Kochi Refinery Propylene Derivative Project. So that has given us an edge and given EIL the experience and a strong base to go into these areas. So these are the projects that we are talking. It would be probably a little premature to share exactly which are the ones and how we are strategizing to target these projects. That's one. The second part which we are looking is into the stronger presence in the sector of infrastructure where there is a lot of investment. The more important thing today is the transformation of the company to looking into greener technologies, looking into green hydrogen, looking into being there when the energy transition is happening. So we have already some clients who we are working for in terms of the biofuels. You are aware that we are working for the bamboo refinery in Assam for Numaligarh refinery. We have also secured a DFR feasibility, which is a step towards the project from NTPC, again looking at the biomass. This is again a diversification in the area as well as client base. We are also looking into other sectors which are neighboring sectors, complementary sectors, and as and when they mature, I think we would share with you as to how these business opportunities mature. Our focus in terms of internationalization is still strong, and we have a reasonably sized setup at Abu Dhabi, and the focus is to kind of strengthen it and try to expand our own business base there, which helps us in getting more international business. That's the main thing in broad detail. One is the expanding our horizon, looking at more diversified areas, expanding geographies. There are certain projects which we have detailed out. I think time will be able to share once they mature and look at that target of 5K25.
Thanks, ma'am. That's useful. Just one quantitative number. Of this 5,000 crore, how much would be coming from oil and gas segments, and how much we think could come from non-oil and gas? Just a broad number based on whatever we see visibility in the next 2-3 years.
Now, it's as you are quite aware, it's like a very, very difficult difficult answer to give you a value for it. We will be doing our best and endeavoring to expand the non-oil and gas. But considering the fact that India is dependent on a significant amount of imports of oil, and we import almost 85% of our crude oil, it's very difficult. I mean, you probably will end up in the Caribbean if we are able to predict. So I don't think that's a possibility for us. But the point is that we as a company want to be in the newer area so that we continue to be relevant in the emerging sector, continue to have the competency and capability and the experience to be there when the industry needs it. Needless to say, some of these sunshine sectors may not stand alone on their own in terms of their returns when you compare it to the conventional sector of oil and gas. So only time will tell how the policies emerge, how the market dynamics prevail, how the technology components in terms of all this, how the cost curve moves for them, how it is adopted and integrated in the oil and gas sector as well beyond the devil. It's like that, but we want to be there when the transition is happening so fast, so we are enabling ourselves to be there in the diversified sector. And our teams are doing a fairly good job in terms of both scouting for projects as well as implementing them.
All right, ma'am. Thanks. I'll come back for later questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. The next question is a follow-up question from the line of Anuj Sharma from M3 Investments. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks again. Ma'am, we have in the AGM talked about a lot of changes in the way we are bidding and the mix change. Can you just elaborate, and what is the win ratio we've been able to achieve, or what is the target win ratio?
Could you repeat your question? We could not get your question clearly.
Yeah, in the AGM we have said that we are introducing a number of changes in the bidding document to improve our win ratio, right, to become more competitive. So can you just enumerate on some of them, and could you also highlight how we expect the win ratio or the bid win ratio to evolve in the next 3-5 years?
If I understand correctly, you mentioned that in the AGM, I communicated this, right?
That's right.
Okay, let me get the transcript and look at the context.
All right. Till then, I could ask another one. You know, we have set up a portal called Lakshya Bharat for information dissemination. Does this portal have a revenue model?
The roles of EIL are twofold. One is, of course, to deliver sustainable, profitable growth. This is one objective as a corporate. But we are under the aegis of the ministry, and we are hence also the pillars of building the manufacturing base of the nation. In that context, as you may be aware, one of our vendor enlistment cells, which is there, has created a base of vendors in the oil and gas industry for all type of equipment, any and every type, whether they are fabricated or they are supplied. So it is but natural that we extend this to a broader platform, which is nationwide, which is the Lakshya Bharat. Now, when you're talking of business, how does it come back to us? We look at it in two ways. One is, we get much more indigenization, and if I recollect the numbers correctly, there are not less than 15 Indian vendors that we have added in various categories, in wherever they were imported. Components which were imported by international players within a span of 1.5 years. So that is the kind of value addition which has been done by the Lakshya Bharat or our vendor cell, which is now transforming to Lakshya Bharat. Now Lakshya Bharat has, therefore that brings, what does that do? That brings in competitiveness into the industry. So the business or the efficiency which we execute our job, if there is a lot of competition, then it is an ease for us to get competitive with. So it is easy for us to execute jobs. If we have more Indian suppliers, we are better complying to the guidelines of public procurement and the GFR guidelines. So it indirectly assists us to make our execution of projects simpler with more competition. So if you say it's a direct benefit, probably the answer is a little indirect, or would I say it's a consequential benefit to EIL.
All right. And ma'am, on the bidding strategy evolution.
Yes. So again, there are two parts to this. One is the strategy for bidding, and the second part is the operations and execution of that. Successfully won bid. The strategy which we are following in bidding is, as I shared with you earlier, we are not restricting our focus to just the oil and gas. And that is the one most important thing. So we are reaching out to every other sector in a very focused manner to see where all our core competencies and our related competencies can add value and garner business for EIL. So that is one very focused attention or widening our strategy to those areas as well. That's one part. The second part in terms of the management of projects, we are in terms of execution, that is it's again a process which involves a lot of stakeholders. So it is a very difficult one size fit all, because every location is different, the complexity of projects is different. The contractors who work in one site do not perform in another site. So there are a lot of issues in the execution. Nevertheless, there has been already dialogue with a lot of clients how to ease out the terms, particularly for the contractors, in terms of enhancing cash flow. You would be aware that the PBG has been reduced significantly to enhance cash flows, because that becomes a major issue in execution, in cash in hand. So we are always, whenever we do review meetings, whenever we discuss with clients, we try to ease out these a priori these issues, so that the execution part becomes a little easy, and that is again being done in a more focused and a more consolidated manner.
All right, ma'am. And one last quick question. The Numaligarh refinery extension, which is from 3 to 9 MMTPA, would entail a capex of around 28,000 crores. Now, we being equity shareholders with 4.37% stake, would we be also, how will the capital allocation work in the incremental capex? That will be helpful. Thanks.
Okay. It will be in the same proportion, so our stake will continue to be retained. It will not be diluted in any way. It will be retained because for making, number one, we are guided by the, it has to, essentially, let me put it short, it will remain the same even when we go to expansion.
All right, ma'am. Thanks for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Bhumika Nayak from DAM Capital Advisors Limited. Please go ahead.
Yes, good evening, ma'am. Just wanted to understand our order intake pipeline. We've had a fairly healthy order intake in the first half of about close to 1,500 crores. What are we looking at in the second half and, in the next 2 to 3 years, if you can talk about the pipeline, both from hydrocarbons, also in terms of, the non-hydrocarbon space that you spoke about?
So what there is a target that we have to meet as per the MOU that we signed with the ministry, and as per that we have what's the exact
200, but in terms
of all right. So we are looking at something close to 1800 is our target. And let's hope we do better than that. We are trying our best.
Right. And is it possible to get some more, color in terms of what are the likely orders which would come through in the next 12, 18, 24 months? Which areas, Yes, sir.
Bhumika, we are into competitive bidding on a number of projects. The visibility of projects which are coming up in the industry. Since they are on competitive basis, we would not be able to declare immediately. No matter whenever we get those projects, we will definitely share the data as we have been doing through press and media and through stock exchange. But definitely we have kept these targets considering the projects that are going on and we are bidding. And hopefully we can do better.
Right. The second aspect of the question is related to, you spoke about the fact that, we'll try and look at some non-hydrocarbon space as well, whether it be infra and water, etc. Now, as we diversify into these segments, how will the margin profile, move? Because typically these, hydrocarbon in our consultancy segment, we have anywhere margins between 25% to 30%. But would it be possible to continue getting these kind of margins in the non-hydrocarbon space, the infra, etc.? And how will you balance that out?
There are two. The decision making for entering the sector is not subject to the confirmation of a margin of 20%. So let me put it this way. The essence of entering a new sector is that if we do not, as a company, we remain without the experience of that new sector. So it is a strategic decision many times, and it is again case-to-case basis one has to look. There is no one rule for how we bid. It depends. If we are having core expertise there, then you are entitled to the margin. But if it's a strategic entry, then the entry is more important. So it is on a case-to-case basis which these calls have to be made. And however, to dent the bottom line is not the intent. So the intent is to maintain a robust bottom line. I think that is the way we will look at all the the newer areas and the newer projects that we will try to enter.
Bhumika, to take this point forward, even in the current mix, yes, we have seen we have a number of projects of different sizes and capacity. Some the margin profile of each of these jobs would be different. So we have been trying to optimize both the top line and the bottom line for a sustainable growth. The idea is to enter into new sectors, take strategic decisions also while entering, but in the long run, for sustainable growth, these new sectors will also give us reasonable top line and bottom line. So that's why we are trying to enter.
Okay. So basically what you're saying is, even though the margins may be not comparable to the current levels, but incremental business will basically add to the incremental bottom line in that sense, and that is how we are trying to look at it.
Not just in percentage terms, you have to see in the volume terms also. The data volume has to be improved upon.
Yes, that's what I meant. Yeah, okay. And lastly, just on the international side, the crude prices moving up, are we seeing, ordering activity or, capex cycle improving and them trying to look at players like us, especially, if you can just comment on how the international landscape is, any potential orders out there over the medium term?
We are seeing a mix and match of both. You would have seen the impact of low crude oil prices and the impact of pandemic, and also the new energy mix which is coming up, the concern for the environment and the new green technologies which are being taken up, EVs being introduced in most of the countries. So even Middle East countries have become more conscious. They are also very selective in their expansion projects. But yes, with the improvement in prices, they are going ahead with some of their projects, but they are also rationalizing their capex and costs. So we are seeing a mix and match of both. On the Indian context, we have from our honorable ministry and the government an initiative and focus to expand overseas also. Not just EIL, our vendors and contractors as well, and to bring in more forex. So we are also trying to do that. We'll try to expand our international operations. Currently also you are seeing that we have a good mix in international and consulting.
Okay, great, sir. I'll come back in the question. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Samarth Singh from TPF Capital. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. Could you please give us an update on RFCL and what capacity we are running at today? Thank you.
Yeah. So the RFCL unit is, since it's a fertilizer unit handling a lot of solids in terms of bagging and dispatch. It has now stabilized and it is currently operating at around 70% of its capacity.
Thanks. And is there any plans of spinning off this business or sort of monetizing part of our investment?
Selling RFCL? Oh, no. So, see, you are aware that it is governed by the UDR policy. And so our investment there, close to 491 crores, is already fetching a post-tax return of 12%. The RFCL?
RFCL, yes.
Yeah. So we are already having an assured return in terms of the investment we have made. Since it is one of the projects which are under the Prime Minister's fertilizer revival, it is very crucial to the country in terms of minimizing urea imports and having both self-reliance as well as a sustainable supply. So since on pure financial terms, since it is going to get us a good return, which is again policy driven, since it extended to our unit also, we don't see any reason why we would need to sell the investment, hive off our investment to any other party.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. As there are no further questions from the participants, I would now like to hand the conference over to Ms. Bhumika Nair for closing comments.
Yes, ma'am. Just one thing before we end the call, just one question on my side. We have obviously a fairly, you know, despite the investments in NRL and Ramagundam subsidies, is there any plan to invest further any of these cash or any thoughts behind this strong cash book that cash balance that we have?
See, as a company, we are open to good projects with assured returns in sectors which are related to us or something very significant which we would value in a future. So we are open to continue this, continue to invest in promising projects.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you, everyone. I mean, thank you, ma'am, to the entire management team and ma'am for, you know, your time and for the call. Really appreciate giving us an opportunity to host you and wishing the entire team all the very best.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of DAM Capital Advisors Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.